Thank you so much to Chair Christopher Browning and the Lawyers Conference of the American Bar Association Judicial Division for selecting me from among the many outstanding nominations submitted this year to receive the Robert B. Yegge Award. Many thanks to the judges who nominated me, Judges Ayuade, Darcy Hoke, Gerald Kelly, Catherine McDonald, Gene McKinney, our Patricia Miles, who is here, Judge Miles, who's come all the way from California, Stephen Roscoe, and Eric Wildgrube. I am deeply humbled to receive this prestigious and coveted honor. And I want to thank President Klein and incoming President-elect Bass for their remarks this morning about the independence of the judiciary. I want to use this opportunity to make a few comments about public service, about equal access to justice, and what motivates me every day. Dr. Martin Luther King, the Nobel Prize laureate, noted that darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. Hate cannot drive out hate. Only love can do that. So this valuing of love, his teaching about love, has inspired me to bring love into our conversation, into our workplaces, into our courtrooms, into our rules. Love, the leadership of valuing everyone. The California Public Utilities Commission employs over 1,000 employees to regulate all utilities in California. Since becoming the chief judge in January 2009, we have focused our efforts on making the decision-making process at the commission transparent, accessible, and efficient. We've also made a concerted effort to make sure that safety is a key factor in our decisions. Our commission began as the Rail Commission back in 1911, and we continue to oversee rail safety in the state of California. The important work we do affects millions of Californians, 41 million residents, and billions of dollars. The California economy is a global force as the sixth largest in the world. The history of the Commission's Administrative Law Judge Division began in 1947 as the Department of Legal Examiners and became the Administrative Law Judge Division on June 28, 1977. During Governor Brown's first administration. Last month, we celebrated our Ruby Jubilee, the 40th anniversary of the founding of the division during Governor Brown's historic second administration. Those of us who have chosen this life of public service to protect the safety, security, and affordability of basic necessities such as transportation, electricity, gas transmission, communications, including telephone and broadband, and water quality, sacrifice every day with lower pay scales, public opprobrium, and limited resources. Against all odds, the judges, attorneys, hearing reporters, support staff, and analysts who toil in our regulatory field do so with integrity, creativity, commitment, passion, and brilliance, despite a cacophony of criticism. Most importantly, we must continue to do so with love. One of our judges, Judge Katherine Kwan McDonald, has noted upon receiving an award from her alma mater, Whittier School of Law, that as administrative law judges, we are the guardians of the record. This resonates with me. The judges are indeed the guardians of the record and the protectors of due process. Administrative law judges are also the face of fairness for most Americans. Most Americans who come before public regulatory agencies of all types, in fact, according to the National Judicial College, most Americans' experience with the legal system and a judge is more likely before an administrative law judge than in civil or criminal courts. Assistant Professor Kent Barnett from the University of Georgia School of Law noted last year that despite numbers and caseloads substantially larger than Article III courts, administrative law judges and administrative adjudicators mostly go about unnoticed, toiling in the shadows. Administrative law judges are held to the higher ethical standards of the Judicial Code of Ethics and, like the lawyers who practice in and before our regulatory agencies, must also adhere to the professional code of responsibility, as well as, of course, our own state statutory ethical and procedural codes. Integrity is the key to our moving forward. We must also continue to speak out against the relentless efforts proposed in the guise of political expediency and so-called reform and deregulation to eliminate the independence and professionalism of the administrative judiciary on both the federal and state level. Our core values of accountability, excellence, integrity, open communication, and stewardship must prevail. Our Administrative Law Judge Division today reflects California's hallmark diversity, and during my tenure has many firsts. We have the first African American chief and assistant chief judges, the first Filipino judge, the first Native American judges, the first Hispanic judges, several Asian judges, and several LGBTQ judges. We are community leaders, philanthropists, lawyers, scientists, accountants, geologists, and academics. Our diversity reflects the mosaic of the state of California. We are the face of fairness and the holders of integrity. However, we are also a striking anomaly even within the CPUC, which continues to be a predominantly white institution. It's hiring limited by recruitment from within, not only the utilities industries, but inside its own building. While the commissioners, who are political appointees, appear diverse, their immediate advisory staff of over 26 advisors includes no more than two self-identified blacks, both young lawyers. Of the over 70 lawyers employed by the CPUC, only three are black. And the one black woman was hired by me during my year as interim general counsel in 2014. We must be able to have the conversation about implicit bias. Equity, access, and inclusion without regard to the discomfort it might cause to those who are entrenched and privileged by the status quo. All of us, as officers of the court, both lawyers and judges, owe the American public an educated, unbiased, and independent judiciary, whether in the Article III courts or the executive administrative law courts. I am always conflicted about the American Bar Association. Because of its historic and institutional racism and its demonstrated commitment to segregation in the legal profession and the life of our nation during the Jim Crow era, it remains significant to me that the ABA did not allow African Americans to join until 1943, 65 years after its founding. Even after the ABA changed its official membership policy, it took several decades for the ABA to fully embrace equity and inclusion. I am very proud that Paulette Brown was elected the first African American woman to lead the ABA in 2014, 136 years after its founding. I am also very proud of the work that I did as a member of the State Bar of California's Commission on the Revision of the Rules of Professional Conduct. And as the only African American woman member of the commission, the very vocal and indeed persistent champion of a new and effective disciplinary rule prohibiting lawyers from discriminating against their employees and clients. In 2016, the ABA continued to show great progress toward reconciliation and healing by introducing a new ethics rule prohibiting attorneys from using sexist, racist, and condescending terms. In 2017, our California Commission submitted Rule 8.4.1 to the Board of Trustees, and it narrowly passed. It's now before the California Supreme Court. I'm asking all of you to keep an eye on that, where the lone dissenter of over 25 commissioners is concerned about deleting a pre-adjudication requirement from the rule. The only such clause ever included in any of the disciplinary rules. It's unfortunately garnered the notice of those who wish to maintain the status quo. Sharing power, privilege, and influence is extremely difficult, and it will not happen without great courage and sacrifice. Vice Admiral Nora Tyson, commander of the U.S. Navy's Third Fleet, the very first woman to command a fleet for our Navy, recently noted that any effective organization must have many different perspectives, backgrounds, and methodologies in order to reach the best and most comprehensive solutions. Homogeneous environments are not conducive to progress, to change, to adapting to our changing world. The legal profession, like our armed services, must embrace inclusion and equity in order to be the best. She also noted that although she is the first woman to lead, she does not want to be the last. I thank you all again, and I close with a tribute to the African-American woman pioneer who founded my law school, alma mater, Antioch School of Law, now the University of the District of Columbia's Clark School of Law, attorney extraordinaire and visionary, the late Ms. Jean Camper Kahn, and all who came before me. The program that she and her husband, Professor Emeritus Edgar Kahn, also the founder of the Legal Services Corporation, providing legal representation for the indigent. As President Linda Klein observed, we all must continue to support the Legal Services Corporation. They began the law school in the 1970s, and it was the seminal clinical legal education program, and in her words, teaching law firm. I say her name, Jean Camper Kahn. My parents' names, Julius Caesar and Ella Clopton. My grandparents, Alberta Olivia Archie and Charlie and Cornelia Clopton. And the California Supreme Court's first African American justice, Alan Broussard, who swore me into the California bar 30 years ago. As we remember all who came before me, as our beloved living saint, writer and poet Alice Walker has written, to acknowledge our ancestors means we are aware that we are not the first. That we are aware that we did not make ourselves. That the line stretches all the way back, perhaps to God or to gods. We remember them because it is an easy thing to forget. That we are not the first to suffer, rebel, fight, and love, and die. The grace with which we embrace life in spite of the pain, the sorrow, is always a measure of what has gone before. We have been entrusted to maintain and better our society, one we intend to pass intact and improved to the next generation. Thank you for doing your part and embracing love in your own lives, in your own practice, in your own courtroom. I'm asking you to remember love.